It's all in the shoes. It's all in the shoes. Or stealing a line from the famous ad campaign for Michael Jordan's shoes back in the 90s. It's gotta be the shoes. We are in the midst of our sermon series over the Psalms. The Psalter is what it's appropriately named. The Psalms, these 150 prayers and reflections and utterances of praise that have been compiled and combined so that we would know our God, and we would know our faith, and we would know how God interacts and engages humanity. We have in the Psalms 150 expressions of suffering, of pain, of anger, of frustration, but also of joy, of hope, and of praise. You know, when I thought about this series, this summer of songs, a couple songs came to mind. The first song that came to mind was a little song by George Gershwin, Summertime. And I remember the first time I heard this song, Ella Fitzgerald was singing it. And I remember those first words, summertime, and the living is easy. Amen. I thought it was just me. Amen. And the living is easy. I remember hearing this song with Louis Armstrong in the background, and this slow and sultry song being sung by Miss Fitzgerald. So full of soul, so full of experience, so full of passion. You know, as I listened to the song, it wasn't the generally happy popcorn type of song that we might hear today, but the way she uttered those words and phrases, it reminded me that although she's singing about summertime and the living being easy, Miss Fitzgerald knew something about suffering. She knew something about pain. She knew something about the real problems that exist in this life. I can hear this tension involved in Miss Fitzgerald. And this same tension exists in each and every one of us. We are here today praising the, well, some of us are praising, amen. Some of us are just here. But we are here praising the Lord this morning because we know that God is gracious to us. We know that God is loving to us. We know that God is merciful to us. But also, along with all those things, we know that there are some issues going on in our lives. There are some troubles around our way. There are some things that we have not figured out. We have not worked out. We have not gotten to the end of the trials and tragedy that come upon us in this thing called life. And so we are sitting in the midst of the tension between a God who we know can do all things and the God who has not done them yet. Amen. Somebody up in here. We are living in the tension. Amen. One of the things I love about the book of Psalms is the book of Psalms, I can tell, are written by real people. Amen. I love when people are real. I don't have a whole lot of time for fakeness. I don't have time for fake people. I don't have time for fake words. I don't have time for fake anything. I like what's real. Amen, somebody. If you're not happy with me right now, just say you're not happy with me. I can deal with it. Promise you, amen. But don't come up in my face smiling when we know we have issues, amen. I feel like preaching today. I really, really love realness. I love genuineness. I love when someone can speak from their hearts, knowing that I'm saying it not to tear you down, but I'm saying it in love. And I love the psalmist. I love the psalmist because every time I approach a psalm, I can tell that it's a real person talking about real life and real issues. Amen, somebody. I don't know about you, but I have some real issues in my life. I have some real struggles going on. I have some real things that I cannot just turn my back on and ignore, face and confront. And what is a blessing to me is that I'm not in this thing by myself. Amen. Amen. I love the psalmist because it's the psalms of each one of them are written by a real person experiencing real life and real troubles. Amen, somebody. Real problems, you know what they are. I don't need to tell you, but I'll take some time to talk about them anyway. There are some real issues, even in the community of faith that I'm facing right now. There are some real issues. Amen, somebody. There are some real things that are challenging us and questioning how faithful are you? How connected to God are you? How strong is your relationships? I'm talking about real issues. Amen. I'm talking about real issues like a husband and a wife not getting along and not knowing if you're going to make it. Amen, somebody. I'm talking about real issues where you go to work each day not knowing if you're going to keep your job. I'm talking about real issues. You know those issues even that creep up in the church. Issues where you come to church to be fed and filled. Yet your hidden enemies or your haters are talking about you behind your back. Or they're saying you cannot do this or you cannot do that. I'm talking about real issues. Issues that affect the church. Issues that affect the people of God. Issues that seem to damage our faith. I'm talking about real issues. Issues of not knowing if when you send your children to school, are they going to be taught or are they going to be treated like criminals? I'm talking about real issues. Amen. Somebody's not knowing when you if you're pulled over by the police, if this is going to be a good exchange or one of those other exchanges. Amen. I'm talking about real issues. And we all have to face those real issues. We have to face the fact that sometimes bad things happen to us. Amen. We have to realize that suffering comes upon us every once in a while. You know, I was reading this these words of the great Langston Hughes, and he writes these stories about a man named Jesse B. Simple. Amen, somebody. And Jesse B. Simple said some words that made me think about this passage in a section entitled "Feet Live Their Own Life." Feet live their own life. Jesse said, you don't have to look at my face. You don't have to look at my hands. All you have to do is look at my feet and you can tell what I've been through. Amen, somebody. When you look at my feet, you know that I've been through some real issues, some real struggles, some real problems. When you look at my feet, you know that I haven't just been sitting around with my heels up all the time, but I've had the weight of the world on me every once in a while. I've paced up and down the floor wondering how I was going to make it. If you look at my feet, you'll see that I've had to walk when I didn't have a car. Amen, somebody. If you look at my feet, you know that every once in a while my shoe may have had a hole in it because I could not afford to replace it. You can tell a lot about a person by looking at their shoes. Amen. And as he continued in this story, he reminded us of the fact that even in looking at his shoes, the blessing is that even though he's been through some things, even though he's been through some struggles, the blessing is that he is still here. Amen, somebody. Don't give up on God. Don't give up. Don't walk away. Don't retreat. But you have to continue to be around to see the blessedness that God has in store for each and every one of us. So as we look at Psalm number 30, we see a psalm written by a real person who's had some real struggles. Amen, somebody. And one of the things we see oftentimes, we see Psalm 30 most often in the context of death and dying. Amen, somebody. We often see verse 5 of Psalm 30 as every one of the condolences that we receive when our loved ones pass away. we'll quote, "For his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for a lifetime. But weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning." Now, what I want to express to you is that this psalm is not just about death and dying, but it's about loss. It's about grief. It's about the experiences and suffering that we face in this world. Amen. And I stop by to tell you that all loss does not have to do with death. All grief does not have to do with death and dying. But there are some losses that we experience that we don't grieve properly. Some of us have lost family members. Some of us have lost marriages. Some of us have lost relationships that are meaningful to us. And we have never grieved so that we carry that baggage to the next relationship. And it poisons the relationships that we have in the future. I'm preaching, amen, and I'm teaching right now. Some of us don't grieve properly over the loss of a job, over the loss of an experience, over the loss of things that we hold dear to us. And instead, we hold on to this anger, which leads to depression, and which keeps us from giving God our best. Amen, somebody. When I was praying with the choir this morning, God spoke to me and said, pray that we give God our best in everything that we do. We want to be people who know that God has blessed us to give us God's best, to give the world God's best, and to be excellent in everything that we do. As we continue to look at this psalm, we see that the psalmist says, "I extol you, Lord." To extol means to lift up, which makes sense because the Lord has already lifted the psalmist. And now the psalmist is saying, "Lord, I lift you." It says, "Do not let my foes rejoice over me. Lord, my God, I cried to you for help, and you have healed me. Oh Lord, you brought me up my soul from Sheol, restored me to life from among those gone down to the pit." What this psalmist is saying is this psalmist is saying, "I had a whole new experience of suffering. Suffering is different now. As I've been a faithful person, as I have given more attention to God, I am able to reevaluate what suffering means in my life. Just because you are suffering doesn't mean that God is absent from you. Amen. It doesn't mean that God has walked away or turned God's back from you. But suffering is a part of this life. Amen. I wish I had a witness. Suffering is something that we cannot escape. We cannot walk away from. We cannot insulate ourselves. But we can remain faithful in the midst of our suffering. The psalmist says, "Sing praises to the Lord." Remember, he's talking about his suffering in verses 1 through 3, but he immediately shifts to talking about praising the God who is with him in the midst of suffering. He says, "Sing praises to the Lord, O you his faithful ones, and give thanks to his holy name. For his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for a lifetime." The psalmist has recognized that there's something different about this experience with God. It's not the same as what I've had in the past. And I like being with God. I like living with God. I like having someone on my side, someone in my corner, someone to fight on my behalf, someone to be with me in these storms, someone to be in solidarity with me, someone so that I will know that I have a friend. What the psalmist has learned from the whole experience is that the purpose of his existence is not to suffer, but is to praise God. This understanding of life motivates the psalmist to be a witness to others concerning the character of God. You know, we see this psalm as a reevaluation of suffering. And the first thing we notice is that suffering does not mean that God is missing. As a matter of fact, it means the exact opposite. It reminds us of the hope that we all ought to have. Amen, somebody. It reminds us of the hope that we all ought to have, because we know that we are not in this alone. The other thing we notice about the suffering that exists is that suffering does not endure. And I wish I had a witness this morning to know that suffering doesn't endure. Amen? That means that there comes an end to our suffering if we trust God and if we are patient. When I think about this, the psalmist, and how the psalmist expresses how God acts in suffering, it reminds me of God's timing. God's timing. Sometimes we suffer and we want the suffering to be removed almost immediately. Amen, somebody. I'm speaking about myself now. Sometimes I feel like, what did I do to deserve this? What did I do to deserve the pain? What did I do to have to go through all this? What did I do so that others are seeing me and saying, you know, that's a follower of Jesus, and look how beaten down he is. Look how distraught he is. Look how depressed he is. And I want that suffering to be removed so that I can go back to rejoicing and praising. But it reminded me that things happen in God's own time. Not our time, but God's own time. It's a little Greek called Kairos. Somebody say Kairos. Kairos is time that denotes a special critical point in human history when God's will and purposes are carried out. Let me say that again. Kairos is the very moment when God's will and purpose is carried out in this world and in your life. So when we think things are delayed on our own time, it's right on time in God's time. Amen. Things are right on time. Things are happening when God wants them to happen. Suffering is removed the moment that God says that you are ready to experience the blessedness that God has in store for you. It's not about us not ever suffering. It's about us trusting God and maintaining our hope. Kairos time. The exact moment or point in human history when God's will and purposes are carried out. The psalmist is saying his anger is but for a moment. Now, I'm sure that there's someone in here that's saying, God was angry for me and it was more than a moment. Amen. It was more than a brief moment. It seemed like it lingered for a while. It seemed like it stayed on me. It felt like I wore the anger of God. I had to carry it around like a chain around my neck. But in God's eyes, that anger, that suffering was only for a moment. Amen. And the scripture says, but his favor is for a lifetime. So let me help you out. The anger is but for a moment, but the favor is for a lifetime. So that means the favor of God begins before the anger. The favor of God lasts all the way through the anger. And the favor of God even extends beyond to infinity, to eternity, beyond any suffering or anger that we can experience. So that means that God is always with us. To those that love God and those who have a relationship with God, God does not ever withdraw the favor. Amen. We see also in this text, as we look at verse 6, it says, as for me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be moved. This is the psalmist in his own arrogance. When things were good, amen, somebody. He said, I shall never be moved. I will never be brought down from this point. I will never have another bad day. That's what the psalmist said in his prosperity. But how many of us know that if you are on the mountain high right now, it's just a short fall to the valley? Amen, somebody. You are always on top. Amen. You are always the CEO. You are always driving what you drive and living where you live. You weren't always on top. I stop by to tell you, there may come a time again where you need someone. You need someone to help you. You need someone to reach down and pick you up. You need someone to encourage you. You need someone to give you what you cannot get on your own. And the psalmist says, by your favor, O Lord, you established me as a strong mountain. What the psalmist is saying is that God, even in the frailties of life, has established the psalmist so that even when trouble comes, even when storms come, even when dry periods come, the psalmist can remain strong. Is there anybody in this house this morning that knows that when trouble comes your way, that when suffering comes your way, that when death and dying comes your way, when sickness and disease, when haters and backbiters, when naysayers come your way, you can be as a strong mountain, standing against the test, standing against the evil, standing against all that which comes against you to destroy you. Because God has established you as a strong mountain. It says, you established me as a strong mountain. You hid your face, and I was dismayed. To you, O Lord, I cried, and to the Lord I made supplication. And then it says, what profit is there in my death if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Amen, somebody. Why would the psalmist ask if the dust will praise the Lord? Well, the psalmist realizes that if humanity, if creation doesn't praise the Lord, then the only thing that can is the dust. Amen, somebody. And I don't know about you, but I don't want the dust crying out for me. I can praise God for myself. Even in the difficult times, I can still say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for waking me up this morning. Thank you for starting me on my way. Thank you for giving me the activity in my limbs. Thank you for food on my table, and clothes on my back, and shoes on my feet. Thank you for sending me brothers and sisters who don't mind encouraging me. Thank you for all that you've done for me. Thank you for protecting me. Thank you for looking after me. Thank you for being merciful for me. Thank you for all